Good morning. It feels great to be here again. This is a very unique case, and I thought I'll just put the put it in the right context. Sanjay is going to take over the presentation and talk to you about what progress and what are the issues this particular company faced to get to where it is. I just want to give you a perspective of why this case is so important, not only for this company, but for India and maybe other developing countries as well. India is a growing country, and with the new government, there is a huge impetus on infrastructure. Actually, we are 5 years behind, maybe 10 years behind. So there are lots and lots of tenders coming out, lots of projects being given by the government to for companies to take up, and there is also a backlog of 5 odd years. So you can imagine the market size such a company has. It's a great opportunity for EPC companies. As a matter of fact, companies outside India are getting into collaborations and setting up joint ventures, etc., to harness this great opportunity. It goes into many, many billion dollars. Yeah, this is the good part. Yet, if you look at the performance of the companies and the government, you look at this. I don't have to read through. And this is the data from the Bombay Stock Exchange, one of the most vibrant stock exchanges in the world. Less than 45% of the companies have been consistently growing sales year on year for 5 years. Imagine that the market is growing much faster. It's probably growing at 30-40%. And only 45% of the companies are actually growing consistently in sales. And you know, an EPC company can achieve sales by just some billing, and it's own wish. But if you look at beyond 5 years, say 6 years or 7 years, less than 5% of the companies are increasing sales consistently. Isn't that surprising? Now let's go one level below. How many of these companies are making profits year on year? That's 22% only in 5 years, consistently for 5 years. Profits, I'm not talking about increasing profits, I'm talking about just making profits for 5 years continuously. And less than 7 years, more than 7 years, the number drops to very low, maybe 5%. As a matter of fact, we are finding that rarely a company has consistently made profit 7 years in a row. Now, if you go to the next important element for number for a EPC company, which is return on capital employed, nobody has more than 25%. As a matter of fact, 70% of these companies either shut down in say 7 years, or they are taken up by another company as a distressed sale. That's the situation. And look at the market is booming. But somewhere, the way the government operates and the way the companies operate, this is the performance of the companies. Right? Look at this. Most of the EPC companies do not have any infrastructure. No plants, no machinery, no logistics, nothing. They just take contracts, give it, outsource it to vendors, take material from them. They put in people to get the erection and commissioning done. So actually, there is very less capex involved in this business. That's one of the great attractions for many people to come into this business. Yet, if you see, in India, most of the companies have a working capital turns of 0.8 to 1.5. Right? An interest coverage ratio, 60% of them have an interest coverage ratio less than one, which means earnings before interest do not cover the interest cost. That's the situation, right? So it does not mean that a booming market companies do well. And the situation is that most of the companies get into a sector, be there for 4 or 5 years, and then get out. And one of the main reasons that they give for getting out of this business is we don't make money in this business. This business is not lucrative. But then nearly most of the contracts, I said 20%, but say even if you say take a conservative figure of 15%, every contract has some margin. Yet people say we can't make money and they're getting out of it. And this is the story of every company, whether it's a part of a corporate or whether it's an individual company. The companies which are not part of a larger corporate die faster because they don't have support system, they don't have money coming in. And those in the corporate, in the large corporate somehow manage to go on for a few more years. So the EPC companies and government desperately need a solution. The government, because of all this, the government is behind in its targets, and the EPC companies are very, very finicky now about taking up projects. Bajaj Electrical's projects and engineering and projects division has probably shown the way out of this whole situation. And it's the TOC implementation company-wide that has shown the way. It's the first EPC company in India to adopt TOC company-wide. And now we have many other clients doing it because of their success, right? It was in the same situation of, as I talked about, as other EPC companies. It is now growing sales nearly every year. Profits are growing, and it's making profits on a sustained basis. And Anand Bajaj here now thinks that he can go from a $300 million company to a $3 billion company, because market is not a problem at all. Even $3 billion is not even 5% or 10% of the whole market. And in when you understand how to execute, how to manage an EPC company, you can take any project. It doesn't mean that you have to be take a project in, say, transmission towers, or you can take any project. Yeah, that's the goal. That's where we are going now. So I just wanted to set the context of this whole case study. And now I'll give it to Sanjay for.
Thanks, Kiran. Good morning to one and all present here. Thanks to TOC ICO for choosing Bajaj Electricals for this award. And our TOC journey is not recent, it's quite long. We started in 2012 by the end of the year, and in real sense is 2013. And we were the first to complete implementation in transmission division. We have actually three divisions, I'll come to the company part of it. And we were the first one to complete in a transmission, power transmission division. And thereafter, I got an opportunity to present Bajaj Electricals at Cape Town 2015 with the story of implementation. Those who were present there must have seen that. And now Pugge Award, it's very encouraging because journey is very tough, as Kiran said. It was a very, very tough task for us, and we feel very encouraged with Pugge. And let me first introduce you to the company. And then we'll see, it's very important to understand the elements which goes into power transmission and power distribution. I'll take up those one by one. And then we'll talk about the problems which we faced, and then the injections, then what improvements we brought, how it looked in the financial results, and what awards we got finally. This company is quite an old company, very well known. Our founder, Mr. Jamnalal Bajaj, he was known to be fifth son of Mahatma Gandhi. He adopted him as his son. He was a philanthropist. He established this company in 1938. This means we are around 8 decades old. We are pioneering electrical appliances, lighting luminaires. These two areas itself cover around 2/3 of our turnover. And 1/3 turnover comes from projects, of which lighting projects is a very small part. Around 15% of the project business come from lighting projects. But these are the ones where we started with. Then we diversified into turnkey projects that is related to power transmission and power distribution. That is in year 2002. It's a very recent phenomena. We also set up a manufacturing plant where we manufacture for lighting applications, lighting high mast, monopoles, stadium mast, and the transmission towers. This is going to be the flow of this presentation. We'll start with the challenges. I would like you to introduce what the transmission industry is all about. So it's nothing but from the source of power, from wherever we are generating power, we have to reach it to the substations. And transmission is the means of reaching. And from there, normally when it is from power station, the voltages are very high. It's in the range of 765 kV or 400 kV. We call it a interstate transmission network from one state of India to the other state. And then within the state, the transmission is done at a lower voltage, kV rating, say around 220 kV or 132 kV. And that is called as sub-transmission. And then comes the third part of it from the 66 kV, we further go down to 33 kV, 11 kV, and to the LT, low tension, that is 220 volt. That is called as a power distribution part of it. So we are into transmission, we are into sub-transmission, we are into the distribution. We are in the all segments of transmission industry. And the hallmark of this project is that we have to cover vast area of geographical areas, and then we have to erect those towers, string conductor. And typically, if you look at the kind of work we do, first is the foundation part of it, civil foundation, where we need cement, steel, aggregate, and then we construct a foundation over which tower is erected. Then comes cross arms, accessories, conductors, insulators, hardware. So these are all part of tower which is required. Then you find some terminology here, A, B, C, D. This is very important to understand this, what is A, B, C, D is all about. Normally, anybody will start or would like to have from start point to the end point a very straight transmission line. This means we should cover the distance, shortest distance is a straight line. But actually, it doesn't happen. You'll find hills, you'll find rivers, you'll find highways, railways. So you have to take deviations. When a transmission line moves in the straight direction, the towers which are used are the lightest one because lateral loads are not there. When it is moving, it's only a suspension mode, actually. The conductor is being suspended from one tower to the other. So that terminology is A type of tower. These are the lightest tower, and these are the maximum numbers because most of the time we like to travel in the straight line. Then comes B type of tower. If we take a slight deviation, let's say from up to 15 degree, if the deviation in the line is up to 15 degree, the tower is classified as B type of tower. And if the deviation is up to 30 degree, between 15 degree and 30 degree, it is classified as C type of tower. And when the deviation is between 30 to 60, it is called as D type of tower. This means by the terminology itself, we can understand D type tower is the heaviest kind of tower. And all these B, C, D are called as angle towers, and A is called as suspension tower. I'm just mentioning you this because I'll be using this terminology later. And now coming to the lowest spectrum, I talked about transmission. Sub-transmission is also similar to that. Now let's come to the distribution part of it. Power distribution means reaching light to the poorest at their villages. When we look upon India, it's around 400 million villages we have. Sorry, 400,000 villages we have. I'm sorry. So 400,000 villages we have, and when the government, new government came in power around 2014, the target was by 2019, that is the next election, not very difficult to guess. They wanted power to all houses. Okay, that is the agenda they have set in. From that perspective, almost, but they have done a very good job, really. This government has done an excellent job, and we have already covered around 80%. They are at 80% mark. They've done a very good job. And our job is to reach the electricity to the last mile. You can see that house where you can see a bulb. It's a very small connection. They do not own appliances. So maybe a lamp and they can study kind of thing, but only thing is that's a very important milestone as far as their life is concerned. And these projects basically consist of from the substations which are at lower voltage, say around 33 kV, to the LT lines. This means we have a substation of a lower rating, we have poles, we have conductor, distribution transformers, and whole lot of things, quite a number of items must be ranging around 250 to 300 SKUs. Unlike transmission, where the number of SKUs are very, very low, maximum around 20, that's all. So from transmission to distribution, the differentiation, there we have less number of SKUs, and here we have very large number of SKUs. Now let's see challenges which we face. This is common for both, actually. We have national grids, which have to be connected, actually, from one high rating substation to the other one. These lines could be as long as 500 kilometers. I've seen lines with the 800 kilometers also. Then when we come to a sub-transmission, the distance is reduced. It can be 50 kilometer, 100 kilometer, that is intrastate, within the state, at a lower voltage. And when it comes to distribution, then it is connecting those from small substation to the villages. So this is a very wide step, geographical areas which we need to cover. And in addition to that, there are plenty of legal hurdles. India is a democratic country, everybody knows it. Very, very difficult, because once you pass through those villages, though there is an act, Indian Telegraphic Act, whereby there is a right of way available to the government to install towers and poles, but still there is a lot of resistance. There are procedures for the crop compensation, if the crop is there when we do work, or land compensation to get the right of way. One has to get legal approvals if we are working in a government land, the district collectors come into picture. Then if you're crossing a railway line, railway officials, highway authorities, and if you're crossing forest or rivers, environmental ministry. Then the process itself is very tough, because all these projects are mostly handled by the government agencies. They are our client. Off late, there is private participation also. But the process remains long. You have to, as you get an order, you have to get vendor approval, then document approval, manufacturing clearance, inspection call has to be raised, inspector is nominated, he comes for inspection, then he makes a delivery note if he's satisfied, then the road permit, then dispatch, and then physical receipt. So it's a very lengthy process. And then seasonality. This curtails down the total amount of time available with us to do the job. Because in India, there's a 4 months of monsoons, which is a rainy season, basically, starting from June, July, August, September. And it's very difficult, because our work is outdoor. In the villages, we can't approach during monsoons, so works become very slow. And then when there is harvesting going on, people have a natural tendency to resist, and we have to slow down the work. And another major problem we face is the scarcity of skilled laborers. And in addition to that, if there is a discontinuity in the job because of right-of-way problem or RW problem, or because of monsoons, or because of harvesting, then these people tend to run away. They would not like to come if they do not get work for the whole year. So they wouldn't like to have interruptions, and they don't want to lose their livelihood. So these are all challenges we face while we work. Just to give a pictorial view, there's a sugarcane field which we have cleared because we want to do foundation work. Machineries have to move there. You can see a tower being erected in a hilly area, hilly terrain. Then taking help of local police authorities to persuade farmers to allow us to work. And then rivers where we need to install the tower. These are all construction stage pictures which I presented here. Similarly, in power distribution, the problems are of different kind. People do not want the pole to be outside, just outside their home, so they are arguing. Remove from here, you can put it anywhere. I want electricity, but don't want pole outside my home. We have to. Then there are remote, distant areas which we need to cover. There are villages which have got 10 people, only 10 persons in the village. Because it's a government mandate, we have to reach electricity. We can't do it. Then small window we get for harvesting, as I told you, if there's a wheat plantation, you can see. If that is there, working becomes very difficult. Then for the substation, finding land becomes difficult. These are small substations, small land, but still. And many a times there is a change of scope because the condition of the ground is so bad. Nobody has realized once we go there, we find many things are not there in the contract itself. So we have to face that. Therefore, no projects actually could be delivered on originally scheduled time. I'm in this business for the last 7 years. And from 2010 onwards, I find very, very difficult to deliver projects on time because all these problems, which are external actually, not made by us, these prevent us from giving projects on time. Now, what is the intuition, common intuition? It looks like a very hopeless case because the things are external to you and you can't change the world around you. It is not possible to do that. So what we can do? At most we can do is analyze what are the wastages which we are creating. Now we'll talk about what is the impact on business before coming to the cloud, conflict cloud and the solutions. It is very important to understand how project operates in India. I have taken a hypothetical example. Let's say value is 2 billion Indian rupees. 80% of it, which is around 1.6 billion, is supply portion. This means we have supply components, only we have to supply, that's all. And services, this means we have to make foundation, we have to erect towers, we have to string conductor. All this comes in 400 million. And both the contracts are interlinked, but they are given separately. This means we'll get two contracts from the government once we are lowest in the bidding. One will be for the supply, other one will be for the services. And these will be interlinked. This means, how do we get the payment is very interesting part. Once we supply the material, we are given 70% of our quoted price on supply. And as we do progressive work, on erection of towers, we get another 10% of tower, only tower. This means conductor and other items we have supplied, we will not get any money, that will be 70% only. As we erect towers, we get 10%. As we erect more towers and we string that section, then we get for tower, we get for hardware, we get for conductor, another 10%. And similarly for distribution, as we complete a village, this means we have put a transformer, distribution transformer, we have taken feeder lines, we have given it to the homes which have been identified by the government, then we get another 10%. And if we finish a cluster of villages, which is identified by the government based on a block they have in mind, and we get another 10%. This means at best, we get only 90% till we hand over the complete project. And believe me, the throughput at which we are working in transmission is only 20%. 70% is what we get. So all the time in the project, we have to borrow money, we have to work on the borrowed money. We cannot generate cash from any of the projects in India. Now coming to the service, picture is a little better. We get 90% as soon as we finish the service, and another 10% is retained till the last project, till the handing of the project. And this is one of the best contract I have quoted you here. Otherwise, there are many projects where we get zero on supply. We get only once we install those. So even those kind of, the situation will be still worse there, actually. It's very clear, it's very evident that more time is taken for project completion or operational closure or financial closure. I'll come to those definitions later. The more is going to be the outstanding and the debtor account. And more money we have to bring in from outside to run the project. Now the same example, what we have been doing prior to we started TOC journey. We thought because profit is a percentage of sales. So if we maximize our sale, the profit is bound to come, right? So what we did, we maximized our sales turnover. How? Obviously by cherry picking, supply high value supply item because we used to get 70%, which is around overall 56% of the contract value. If 80% is supply, we get 50% of chunk barely by supplying the material. So why not supply the material? We do the billing, automatically profit is booked straight away. take large production batches at our plant. This means we would love to have D-type towers to be done first because they're the heaviest tower. You complete that and dump at the site. You get payment, 56% payment. Do it. Then, as soon as we get projects, we are least bothered about completing old projects. As soon as we get new projects, we'd love to dump. We'll just buy the material because maximum material is bought out. In plant, we manufacture only tower, so we'll buy the material from outside. Capacity is not a constraint. We have number of vendors available with us. You just buy the material, dump the material, get the billing, book the profit. So that is the way most of the companies in India operate for EPC. Now, what is the vicious cycle here? I'll start with you can start anywhere actually, but I'll start with the vicious cycle from the cherry picking part of it. We used to pick up high value items, and then full kits are not available at site. Then we are forced to open many sites, and the sites will have a slow progress because the metal is not there in full kit, it's in part item, and it leads to delayed client billing, especially when it comes to the other part of it. Maybe we have got the payment against supply, but what happens to the payment which is supposed to be there for the first milestone? What happens to the payment which is attached to the second milestone? What happens to the retention? So all these are delayed billing. Therefore, working capital wastage is there. Site has to run, people have to be there. Site expenses will continue. Therefore, low profitability. Low profitability will lead us to go for higher top line because we believed if we bill more as a percentage of that, we'll get profit automatically. So that was the vicious cycle which was going on. And in transmission business environment, there are two major elements. Why I'm pointing out these two? Because in the initial years, we concentrated only on these because a very, very complex environment. So we picked up only these two. The first one was the plant, where I would like to start with this vicious cycle here, because we wanted to, there was a pressure to improve productivity because we believed we make more tower and we send more, we get more payments and more billing, more profit. So the pressure started from here. This is our own plant. Plant started cherry picking fabrication. They would love to have heavy towers to be done first. And then there was a mismatch for the erection. And then frequent requests from sites because they wanted everything. They wanted A-type tower, B-type tower, C-type tower, D-type tower, and they wanted extensions too. If there is an undulated land, any tower may have an extension. Normally for 400 kV, the tower height is around 50 meters. And if you want to cross a mountain, maybe you have to have extension of 15 meters. If you want to cross a railway line, you have to have another extension of 30 meters. So likewise. But those extension and everything requires change in setup time, and therefore plant was not interested. And then frequent setup changes were there because the site used to demand, we need that kind of tower. Therefore, poor plant productivity and so on. Now, coming from the site perspective, there was a focus on maximum billing. There was a pressure from the head office, do maximum billing. So they used to get this high fabrication, high value items. And there was a mismatch and large gaps on the sites, slowing down of erection because they, in transmission, it's very difficult to string conductor if all the towers are not in place. Even if one tower missing, you can't complete the line. So simple. And another part, very important. The most important problem today in transmission is right of way. And right of way, because we go there to the farmer's field to first do the foundation, poor fellow has to sacrifice his crop. Even if you compensate him, they have emotional attachment with the crop, human psychology. Then you sleep over it because you have not got that particular type of tower. Next season comes, again you go there for erection of tower. Then next season comes, you go for stringing. So three times destroying their crop, pretty difficult task with them. So ROW itself is a problem, but in such environment, it becomes a bigger problem even. And poor site productivity, drop in billing, because customer won't take billing unless you do certain milestones, and the vicious cycle again. Now look at the plant environment, how they used to work. Let's say this is a one stretch where I've started with A-type tower, then there is an extension A plus 3, then you find B-type tower, then A-type, then again there is a deviation in angle, D-type tower, likewise. This could be anything. Now, if plant, because there's another issue, because 70% of the tower are A-type tower, only 30% towers are angle towers. So sometime from that perspective, plant would like to pick up all A-type tower first because they got a good quantum in one place. You do one setup and for the 1 month, do only that production and you get very good production. In 1 month, you could get at least maybe around 15-20% of your whole yearly target, so easy. So there was a natural tendency to go for A-type of towers. They will pick up not only one, they'll pick up two projects, project one, project two. Okay, and for one month and the second month, same type of tower, like a typical factory being produced, sent to site. And now look at what happens at site. Now this is what we need at site. This is what stringing sequence is all about. You have manufactured only A, so B and D have not come to the site. Can't do anything about it. You can't do stringing. And wherever extensions were there, even in the A, there are extensions which require change in setup time. Okay? So even those extensions have also not come. So these are also gone. So you can only erect A type of towers, that's all. And you can do nothing about it. The stringing cannot be completed. In fact, cannot be initiated, I would say. Again, coming to the distribution scenario. Here, I told you the problem is totally different. Here, we have a very long list of items to be required, and they have different lead time, right? And in addition to the lead time, they have a very complexity initially when you have to do the first supply. This means you have to get vendor approvals, you have to get drawings approvals and inspections. Once the procedure is established, it's fine, but the initial part is very difficult. And quantum of items, because these are very small items, very, very small items compared to transmission. Because the quantum is very high, number of villages are very high, there have to be, these have to be supplied multiple times. So this means multiple times we have to raise inspection call, multiple times we get the inspection. So it's a very, very complex situation there. So therefore, there was a total desync of items which is required at site for distribution. It was much worse actually there compared to transmission. Now these are the conflict clouds we have. We want to maximize turnover to get profit. Our intention is to get profit. And focus is on opening projects as soon as possible. There, we want maximum profitability. We want to focus on closing because unless we close, we won't get our money. Similarly, we want to maximize turnover. We focus on billing major items and we want to complete as soon as possible. We want to supply full kit to site. And in the plant environment, the production, they want to produce bigger batches. And site wants that stringable plant should be adhered to. Now, under this scenario, for a 24 months period project, there was a delay of around 12 months, poor rate of closure of site versus the opening of new projects. We were opening more of new projects than closing the old ones. And high receivables, very natural because our all retention money is stuck with the government and margin erosion. Now the solution injections. The core conflict is between the maximum turnover versus the subordinating actions to expedite execution. One thing is very clear, if we expedite execution, if we operationally close the projects, operational closure means we do not have any work left. This means all the things as per the defect list of the client has been attended to, line has been handed over to them, is called as operational closure. And financial closure is when we get all our payment and the bank guarantees which we are given to government. So if we can align all the activities, we can subordinate all the activities to the faster execution and the faster closure. So these are the core conflict. And the paradigm which we challenge, that it is not always important that if we take compromising action to improve turnover, that can impact the cash flow, which we have seen. And impact on the cash flow can itself kill the capability to generate turnover. This is very, and that's the reason which Kiran said, so many companies have closed down. They believed that, and when they found their capital is locked up, they couldn't do anything. And the direction of solution was that we have to subordinate everything to the site execution, be it survey of the site, be it WIP controls, which we will come to that, then full kit and the buffer norms for replenishment. Now the key changes which we did WIP for plant. This means plant will manufacture only one project at a time, and that too they will subordinate to stringable plant. They will not go by a particular batch. They will manufacture A, B, C, D, all type of towers and with their extensions depending on what has been identified as a stringable stretch. And when it comes to our procurement and for the power distribution also same thing. As I told you, maximum items are bought out items. So for the bought out items, for high test time, like in transmission, we have to generate initial full kit, including the stringable stretch. And then for the power distribution, we have to first buffer, we have to maintain the buffer norms, and we have to replenish it month after month based on the pace at which we want to continue. And the site execution part, that we have to find out the elements where we are going to get paid. For example, if we complete a stretch, we get 10%, 20%. And in case of power distribution, if we finish a village or a cluster of village, we again tend to get 20% payment. So we aligned all the activities to those goals. Then daily issue resolution and the project monitoring mechanism weekly. So these were the things we adopted injections. Now how the Pugi action happened, project starts with engineering, then comes procurement and manufacturing happening side by side, site execution where we have contractor attached to us, procurement where we have vendors, and then operational completion which I talked about, and the financial closure. So these are the major thing. And what we did in the first year, we identified the flow entity or the billing entity we can call for transmission, stringable stretch, for power distribution, billable village. And in the first year, what we did was we had two prong attention. One was to handle manufacturing plant, other was the site execution. We applied full kit norms and the WIP norms for plant. Like we said, we'll go for stringable stretch. Like we said, we'll have only one project at a time. And then in the site execution, we said we will not be doing foundations everywhere, only identify the stretch, do the foundation, complete it, then you go to the next stretch. And WIP control norms, whereby we cannot have more than one village assigned to one contractor. This means he has to finish one village, then only the second village will be assigned to him, likewise. And our attention was to get the money into the system fast. So we focused on closures, and from there the money started trickling in, and we also focused on financial closure of the old projects. The money came into the system, we could pay contractor, we could pay vendors, everybody was happy, right? Then comes second year we focused on the site execution part of it. This means anything goes to the contractor will go in a full kit. It was easier in transmission, but not very easy in distribution because the number of items was so large, very difficult to keep track. And unfortunately, because we were on ERP, and ERP, once you bill it to the client, it vanishes out of your inventory system. Material has been billed, so there's no control on inventory now. You don't know where the inventory is. So we developed another module, our IT team, which is called as Leap Ahead. We call it Project Leap Ahead, and there, we developed a module whereby the inventory will, after billing, come to that module. It was external to Oracle, okay? And we could keep a tab on it. So that was a change we brought in. And of course, operational closure and financial closure remained our focus all the time. So this Leap Ahead IT module was very, very important for the success of this whole system and very close interaction with the vector team and with the IT team on each and every element. And the most challenging part of this whole exercise, I would say the success depended on IT. And the third year, we found everything's working fine now in the right direction. Everybody had that intuition. But still, money was not coming the way we wanted. And we just further dug into and found out what has happened to our money. Then we found, fine, we said, you finish one village. He finished the village. He went to the next. But the client was smart. Client said, this job is not done. That job is not done. You have to improve on this. Unless you do that, I'll not make you payment. Okay? Similarly, in transmission. He said, you have erected the tower, but I found 5 bolts missing. So I will not make payment unless you do. And the contractor has finished the job as per our WIP norms we have given in another tower. We have given another village. Now, if we call him back, everything gets disturbed again. So purpose is not met. So we make another norm, again, thanks to our IT system, that unless it has been accepted by the client, no contractor bill will be processed. This means contractor job is not only to finish and vanish. He has to finish, show it to customer, get his acceptance, then further. So this means whatever work we were doing, it was just sedimentation. Money didn't flow to us. So we put gates for material and deduction billing. We said we will not make payment to the vendors unless the material has been accepted by client. So we entered fourth year, and this was the most important as far as the power distribution industry, especially in India, nobody has done this before, applying these norms of procurement, BPR norms, to the project environment. It's a very innovative solution given by vendor, very well executed by our IT team. It was not only at the warehouses, it was also at the vendor's place. Now, if we look at the journey, initially it was operational and financial closure, then we kept on adding elements one by one. The most important part is the last part of it, where you know we started getting positive EBITDA, positive PBT, which was a hopeless situation, not able to understand. In fact, Anant is here. He threatened me many times, I'll close down this business. He said, I don't want to do. Because two-third business is very lucrative. It's a consumer durable. We have vendor-based, positive cash flow. Not a single paisa is required. But here we consume all the money and we don't give it back to the company. So he was very right. And look at the financial results. 12, 13, these are all in million Indian rupees. 1.2 billion we lost, then 1.03.86, and four-year journey, that is the 15-16, financial year 16, we got positive EBITDA. Working capital turns, this is the most important terminology as far as the project business is concerned, Kiran also said, because when we say working capital turns of one, it essentially means that to generate 100 million of turnover, we need 100 million of working capital. That is what it means actually, essentially. And if we have a profit margin of, let's say, 5 to 6%, which actually it is at the end of the day, even today, then we earn only 5% or 6% ROC. That's all. But if we increase working capital turns, if we make it 2.5, or let's say if we make it 3, this means we do 300 million business with 100 million money, then this 6% becomes 18% straight away because you have turned your capital 3 times. So that is what we are able to do. We had a journey of positive. This 15% may not be very good otherwise from anybody else's standards, from Indian standards, is very, very good in my opinion, because we are working in a very low margin industry, lot of competition, and still we are able to get 15% EBITDA, return on capital employed. Now this is another important slide. Actually, this talks about the turnover, okay? So I have kept in the last. It was the first in our mind. Now it is the last. It automatically happens. If you take care of other things, this is going to happen. You're going to get growth. Yeah. Awards and recognitions. Highest service billing ratio. If you saw, I showed you 80% is the supply, 20% is the services. So normally you should have 80-20% ratio also in the billing. But look at our ratio. If you look at the last slide, we did a turnover of around 4 billion, okay, in TL. This is the 4 billion turnover we did. And for that, our services billing was 1.7 billion, which is a ratio of 40%. So we became so much of service oriented that the pull to the billing was created by site execution, not by dumping the material. So that is what it means. And production rate at the plant also increased, actually. Plant had a fear that it will reduce because we are making now all type of towers. But with a simple TOC principles, bringing some constraints, removing some constraint, bringing machines, we could increase the production actually higher than before. Then stringable stretch idea was conceived by us, and now it is very widely adopted in whole transmission industry in India. Higher services billing by power distribution company, 1.47 billion, very difficult for them. These are small, small foundations, small towers, small pole, and 1.4 billion billing in a year is a good billing. This is the highest. And for power distribution industry, we actually finished a job ahead of time. And people were surprised. Okay? We have never done before. Nobody has done before. And to add to that, we got 1 million rupees as a award from the Orissa government. This is one state in India, of finishing ahead of time. And believe me, amount is very small, but very precious to me, very, very precious to me. Because nobody ever has got any award from the government in cash. Very difficult to get award from the government in cash. And look at the payment collection. In 1 year, payment collection of 8.1 billion. All because we could do jobs in time. We could finish them. We could make sure there's operationally closed, financially closed. And then vendor management was a new concept for the industry. Then important milestones, we closed around 21 operationally projects and 13 in TL and 21 power distribution. And three projects in TL have been closed financially. When I say financially closure, I told you we have received all our payments and we have got the bank guarantees also back. Bank guarantee means which happens after 2 years of the liability period. So I'm talking about that. That is what our financial closure definition is all about. And then extra capacity of fabrication for power distribution was developed at our plant. And our turnover, as I told you, was 4.2 billion. This year, we finished at 5.3 billion in transmission. Look at our bidding capacity. Bidding capacity is, there is a formula by the government. This is a premier agency, Power Grid Corporation of India, PGCIL. They are the big boss of transmission industry in India. They determine based on your performance. And from 4.3 billion, which was our bidding capacity in financial year 12-13, they have increased it to 11.7 billion. This means we can quote that many projects. They have so much confidence in us. Now, awards. In last 4 years, especially 1 year after we implemented TOC, we have got award for best project management 3 times. Okay, this is a big deal. This is in spite of Tata Power, L&T, and big names which are there in transmission. And our IT project, I would really thank our IT team because that was the instrumental in making it success at a scale which we're talking about. They got Project Leap Ahead, which was developed by them out of the Oracle system. They got a PC Quest Award. And then Bihar government awarded in 2016 our power distribution job, which was done there. I tell you, in India, when the elections happen, the normal trend is if there is incumbent government, always loses, as happened in the case of Obama, okay, this year. So people say he's not working well, new fellow will work well. But in this case, in Bihar, after this project, this government was re-elected, okay? And really, they acknowledged because the power they did, the reaching to the villages, that was the main reason. And Grapevine says, perhaps that is why we got the award. That is why we got the award from the government, because government won election because of us, right? So before I come to close, one observation I had, which is very important, because that is the basic of whatever we do in this implementation to make it successful. In one of the presentation, it was said, it started like this. People are good, really, okay? And it ended like that also, okay? This means there was a lot of bad experience the person had with the people, but I feel it is actually, people is the most important component of this. Because of my experience, which I've been pushing it. And it is very, very important that we must learn what the change management is all about. It's very, very important. Unless we do that, if we don't make a good foundation, I think the building we are going to construct is not going to be strong. And at any smallest tremor, it will fall, I'm telling you. Even if you're able to implement, it will not be success in the long run. If you look at the presentations which were made, I found Microsoft talked about change management, Kirloskar talked about change management, Godrej Consumer talked about change management, Toshiba talked about change management. This means it is cutting across the continents, especially those countries who are democratic in nature. Okay, people know their rights. They want to do, this is my right. Okay, you have to convince them. Very, very important part. And not only that, I found there was an informal session, what happens after whatever Facebook discussions was on CCPM. I didn't, because I'm from industry, I'm not from this fraternity. I didn't understand much, but one thing I understood was there was a lot of problem with the human behavior. Okay? And somehow it was tackled very well, no doubt about that. And then a glimpses of these were seen in yesterday's membership session. I attended that also out of curiosity. And I found some tones were there also, but again handled very well by the people concerned. So it's very important that whatever you do, it is important to handle the human relations. It's a part and parcel. My advice to those who feel is a problem is that why human behaves that way is there are two reasons we must look at. One is at the organization level, and other one is the personal level. So it's important to understand what stage that corporate is into of their life cycle. The behavior of the members of the organization depend on that. And second is, why do they behave that way? So in both the areas, I found there's an author who is a countryman of Eli. He's called as Edesis. He's based at US. He's written two beautiful books. One is about the corporate life cycle. Other one is about the management and mismanagement styles. So I would recommend those who find difficulty in dealing with the people or the organizations, or if they don't understand the behavior, they must go through that book. It'll bring a lot of changes. Then we'll not say, people are good, really. I would say people are really good. Thank you. Any questions, please? If at all, any time is there. Yeah.
Go ahead. Thank you for the excellent presentation. And I have a lot of background, about 6 years in construction. My dad used to string these transmission lines way back in the 50s.
Great.
So heard lots of stories from them. Right. But one of the things that I was thinking about, especially from your contractor's perspective, when I was a contractor, I used to love the fact that the client was not able to complete the project on time. Why? Because I could bill extra for many of the extra works, overstay and others. Was there any such impact for your contractors that their total revenue kind of reduced because they were because of your improved operations?
Yeah, it used to happen earlier. You're right, Manohar. The thing remains that government is very smart, very difficult to. I celebrated that 1 billion rupees. You know why? Because very difficult to get money from the government. Okay, now you're talking about government is also learning over a period of time. See, they have brought in so many areas they've plugged in already. So it's no more lucrative to say if it is an overrun, they already have put in the contract conditions that payment will not be paid. They have learned over a period of time. Now it is very, very difficult to get out of this that because the project is getting, I'd get something extra, not possible. It's better to finish on time, that's always better. Okay, thank you so much. Yeah.